Hi, everyone. Thank you for having me here today. By way of introduction, I think I'm probably a new face in the crowd for most of you, since I don't recognize most of you, so that's probably the case for you as well. My name is Anna Kaltenboeck. I'm the program director for the Drug Pricing Lab at Memorial Sloan Kettering, where I work closely with Peter Bach. And I come to you by way of about 10 years of industry experience in pharmacoeconomics and pricing and market access strategy for the pharmaceutical industry. So where most of your perspectives here today are perhaps informed more from the legal side, mine is from the pricing strategy side. And I'm actually very eager to hand over the baton here to my colleagues on the panel today, to Robert Weissman, the director, president of Public Citizen, and to Amy Kapczynski at Yale Law School, to hear their takes on compulsory licensing under 1498. And so I will go ahead, and Amy, to you.
So first of all, I wanted to thank Jamie and the team at KEI for organizing this. It's a terrific group of people, and already I've learned a lot, which is impressive because this is an area that I thought I was one of the few people in the country who was kind of obsessed with. So I got interested in the issue of this law provision that we'll be talking about, 28 U.S.C. 1498, the government patent use provision, because of the implications of the very high prices for hepatitis C drugs. So I'm sure all of you are familiar with the both significant prices of those drugs, and then probably also familiar with the vast gap between the prices of those drugs and the production costs of those drugs. So between, you know, list price of $84,000 and a couple hundred dollars of a cost of production. Obviously, as a very high prevalence drug, got a lot of people's attention, very high prevalence disease, got a lot of people's attention. Also, from my perspective, as somebody who spends a lot of time thinking about public health, without addressing in a very significant way the prices of those drugs, the clear kind of public health approach, which would involve very widespread prescription of that, was not going to be possible, and I think still is going to be very difficult. So that's how I came to this, sort of interested in existing legal avenues that might provide for far more extensive provisioning of these medicines. this is also an interesting case because we sort of know from all that's public about the drugs that one could provide them very cheaply and still be assured that the company involved was very handsomely compensated for their R&D. At the end, though, I'll come back to a set of cases that I think where there's perhaps equally strong or stronger case for the use of this power. Again, I was attracted to this because of, in fact, the bigness of the Hep C issue. But if you're thinking in practical terms, there's a lot of scenarios in which there might be very little in the way of patent protection, but an important component of patent protection. Think about the EpiPen, right, which is widely described as a generic, right, because the actual drug involved is a generic, but the device is patented. That device provides very little value in innovation terms, but it is the key barrier to a generic EpiPen, which in fact, as a parent who had a child with needed an EpiPen, like, I wanted that device. I didn't want an alternative device. There's lots of reasons to think that, in fact, a competitive EpiPen would do much better than a design around, right? So that's just one example. I'll try to touch a little bit on some others. But where, particularly where you have these sort of minor patents involved, some of the complexities that you might otherwise see, if you talk about a big case like the hepatitis C one, might be minimized. So I'll talk about why I think this is an interesting option, talk a bit about the history, and sort of then some key issues with the use of it, and why I think it's an interesting option, both for the possibility of government directly accessing lower cost drugs and then compensating through the structure of the companies. But also negotiating around this power, if we started to all take it more seriously. I want to touch a little bit on, I think the other important thing that we ought to be thinking about, and clearly, you know, the group that put this together is thinking about, is what do we need in the way of sort of statutory changes to make this even easier to use, more expansive. A lot of what Zach's talking about, for example, are compulsory licensing statutes that would have very clearly reached the private sector. And that's something I'll talk a little bit about. One limitation of the government use provision is that you've got to at least have a good argument that the federal government has both approved it and benefits from this use, right? So there's lots of things to say, I think, about how statutory amendments could make this power more significant and more useful. That's the last thing I'll say is I think about this somewhat related to Jamie's initial point about the limits of price controls more broadly. I've been doing some work at the state level. A lot of states are now interested in questions of price control. And pharma comes back and says things like, well, we'll stop selling to your state, right? And this is one of the things that's happened internationally when countries have gotten more assertive about price controls. So I think you have to think about, even if you think price controls are a better way of dealing with this, you have to think about having a very robust power of this sort in the background, or you are putting the patients at risk because you are at some risk that companies will threaten to, or in fact, walk away. Okay, so that said, let me talk a little bit about the history. Zach already covered a great deal of history. The most important thing to, I think, understand about the statute 1498 is that fundamentally, the government has never been liable for patent infringement in the way that would permit injunctions. So in an initial period, the government simply wasn't, there was simply no court in the land in which you could sue the government for patent infringement. Then 1498, its initial form, there's a few modifications over the year, arises as a waiver of that sovereign immunity, saying, okay, well, actually, we'll accept liability on these terms. No injunctions, only a reasonable royalty, right? That's the history of it, as long as it's a use by and for the federal government. The other thing, and I have a long paper on this, which we'll go through a lot of these details for those of you that are interested. From its first iteration, this is understood as a way for the government not just to deal with things it didn't understand where there was infringement by a contractor, but to ensure that the government doesn't have to pay too much so that you can't price gouge the government. This provision, 1498, is used regularly now in the United States. So a couple of examples. Recent case where the Treasury used it to shield private banks from liability for using patented software to detect fraudulent checks. Army Corps of Engineers relied on it recently to use patented methods to remove hazardous waste. And it's been used frequently in defense, so cases about lead-free bullets, cases about night vision goggles, right? And in all of these cases, the same structure follows. Infringement happens in some context by private parties, but on behalf of or for the government, and in some context by the government itself. And the only remedy that the patent holder has is to go to federal court and to ask for royalties. The examples that we know of in medicine, the Cipro case is the best known recent example where the threat was made in the aftermath of the anthrax attacks that this provision would be used to stockpile Cipro and had very immediate implications. The price was lowered dramatically and government was given a supply assurance. I think a lot of us who worked on this or knew about this thought for quite a while that that was the only instance in which it had been used for drugs. It turns out that that was not the only instance in which it has been used for drugs, and that's a misconception. This provision actually has been used many times to buy generic drugs by the federal government. The history goes back to 1958 when the Comptroller General, who is the head legal figure for government procurement, issued a decision that said you cannot consider patent infringement when deciding on procurement. We're not patent officers. We don't know anything about patents. You give us a bid that's lower, we'll take it. It's not our business to ask about patents. That decision then led to a number of agencies, predominantly the Department of Defense and the VA, because they were big procurers of medicines directly, to start buying generic drugs from Italy. Italy because Italy didn't have patents in any substantial way at the time. So there's a very high-profile Pfizer case where the agency is buying antibiotics simply because they're 72% cheaper. So this bid came in cheaper. Why would we not buy this? There's one year in the 60s where the Department of Defense did 50 drugs this way, procured this way. This caused great consternation in the industry, which tried very hard to amend the law. And most of what we know about this practice comes from these hearings, where pharma came in and said, we have to amend this law so that this power is only useful for purposes in the context of national emergency or national security risk. That'll sound familiar to some of you who've been around these debates. And those hearings are really interesting because they both give a flavor of the history of these. There's not cases about them because the best that I can tell, a pharma always simply agreed to a royalty and never litigated the question of what the royalty was. So there's no case law. But there's a lot of experience. It's documented in these hearings in particular. And when the industry tried to change this law and narrow it, the Comptroller General and other figures from government came in and said, well, how are we going to deal with excessive prices in that context? This is what we do. This is a power that we have. It's important for us to have. It's been around since the wars where we worried in particular about price gouging, but this is what it's there for. The law wasn't changed. The law is the same as it was since the 1940s. Okay, so that's a bit of history that I think is helpful to know. But what I want to talk about with the rest of my time is answers to, I think, discussion about four key issues with regard to the practical use of this today. So one is about compensation and how compensation should be set. The second issue is about who can be reached by this power. So the limitations implied by the federal component of this power. The third is, what about the FDA and drug registration? And then the last is to talk about the interaction of this with Bayh-Dole and some suggestions about practical ways to explore the use of this in kind of baby steps, if you would. Okay, so these four key issues then with practical use. So, the statute does require reasonable and entire compensation. Reasonable and entire compensation in this context, there's a lot of litigation about this. We have a lot of cases about it because it's used so widely outside of the pharma area. And so we have a fairly robust case law about this. Those of you who are familiar with patent litigation know that there are a lot of factors relevant broadly to the way that damages are set in patent litigation. And those factors are things that the courts refer to when they ask, well, what is reasonable compensation? One of the issues with the use of this, and as Bernie Sanders found out when he suggested that the VA use this, is that agencies want to know exactly what their liability will be. And given the number of factors involved in reasonable royalty determinations, it's hard to say exactly what they'll be. Now, I would say one thing about that that's important to stress is that the government's not going to be paying more than it's already paying, right? And the other is that I think there's a couple of ways to go about thinking about how do you cabin this uncertainty and get to what's the actual royalty going to be? What ought it be? There's one way, which is really what I've focused on, which is providing a legal analysis of the case law and the doctrine to say what's the right approach, what's the leading approach, how would we adapt this to the drug context? Because these cases are typically in other industries, right? How ought we approach it using the doctrine? So I'm a lawyer, that's why I do it that way. It also, though, would be possible to do what Sanders proposed doing, which is to codify an approach to this in statute. I have some thoughts about what could be involved in that. I also think agencies could provide guidance themselves that wouldn't have the force of law, but what it would do was to provide a framework for negotiations. This is how we're going to view an excessive price. This is how we're going to view what reasonable compensation is under the statute. I think that's another possible avenue for providing more of a framework. Okay, so what are the royalty rules? What kind of compensation is actually due under this? A couple of key kind of touchstones in the case law. So one, you don't get lost profits, right? So if you're familiar with patents, you have either a reasonable royalty method or a lost profits method. The lost profits more generous in the sense that you can ask for profits. In this context, case law is quite clear that that is likely never available in this context, that you ask not what the patentee has lost, but what the government in this context has gained. It makes sense. It makes sense if you think about the history of this as a way to think about the government, in fact, preventing excessive pricing. Well, you wouldn't want to turn around and then demand that the government pay the market price. Similarly, the way courts and commentators talk about this is you never had the right anyway in the first place, never, to in fact exclude the government from this use. And so you never had the profits to begin with. Right? Okay, so no lost profits. So then the question is, what's the royalty? If you have an existing royalty, that's very, very influential to courts in these cases, if you've licensed it to something else. Now, that's not going to be the case for a Sovaldi kind of drug. Those don't get licensed out, right, typically, at least certainly not in markets like the U.S. For some of these other, if you're talking about ancillary patents, a device patent, maybe in some of those cases you'd have an existing royalty. That's very likely to be that something that the court is either going to just adopt or would take very seriously as a baseline. Okay. But often I'll say we won't have a royalty to draw on. So what do the courts do in this case? So the leading approach in the case law to this is that you take as a baseline the what I'll call in this context the generic company's profit, the infringer's profits. And you say, well, what are their profits? Take some evidence about that. We say, well, some of that's got to go to the patent holding company. And then let's gross it up, let's increase it, adjust it if the patentee, is a quote from one of the recent cases in 2012, if the patentee took the risks and bore the expense of R&D. I think that's actually a pretty good approach, right? You say, okay, well, let's start with a baseline in this context because generic drugs tend to be far less. You take a percentage of their profit, it's not going to be, that's not going to be a very substantial baseline from which to start. But then you back out of that and you ask what is ultimately the kind of public policy question that I think is the right one, which is, what was the R&D investment here? I think the best way to do this is actually also to think about risk-adjusted R&D, right? In these cases, it's the burden is on the patent holder to show this. So they would come to court and they would say, here are R&D costs. Here's how we think you should incorporate that into the payment that we are due. I think that, the way to deal with the fact that companies are only investing, let's say, $300 million in, you know, R&D or a billion if you think the number is really big, but there's a risk that they'll fail, is not to pay for all their failures in some sense, but, you know, to adjust for the risk, right? If there was a 1 in 5 risk that this would fail, then you ought to be entitled to that additional multiplier to ensure that you get sufficient compensation so that the next time around, you'll make a reasonable decision to invest wherever the benefits would be greater than the costs. We also proposed in our paper that you could add a sort of reasonable profit to this. That's not actually in the case law, but I think it would be a reasonable approach if you were an agency to take in the sense that you could talk about industry-level profits and add some component to that. I think that's helpful if you think as a political matter you need to address the concern that there won't be enough profit in the industry. Okay, so if you work this all out as we do in this long paper version, for a drug like hepatitis C, given what we know publicly, which is certainly not everything, but we have some ballpark figures for R&D costs and risk and so forth, you could easily come to judgments of several hundred million or several billion dollars, right? We come to probably something around $5 billion. Again, this is all back of the envelope kind of stuff, right? So big payments that, in fact, would compensate handsomely for R&D and adjust for that risk as well. So I think practically speaking, of course, the other thing that would be likely is that as soon as this was seriously announced as a possibility, there'd be negotiations about what the price would be. And, you know, if the history has anything to say about it, companies have reasons to not want to, in fact, go to trial to establish an approach to royalty setting, I think, in some with some fear that that will simply institutionalize the practice. Okay, second question, who's covered by this? So under 1498, you need the use to be for the federal government and with the authorization and consent of the federal government. So the government must benefit, and the government must approve in some sense. And this makes sense when you think about this as a sovereign immunity waiver, right? So it's the government's sovereign immunity, and so it's got to be for the government. If the government has no idea about this and is not implied, then it's just a contractor socking the government with some liability payments that the government had no idea about, right? So that's sort of what's going on in these two requirements. The case law is interestingly quite broad on both of these prongs. So with respect, for example, to consent, consent can be expressed or implied. It can come before the case, or it can come during the case. And so sometimes the government will just show up in the middle of a case and say, yep, we consent. We will cloak you with our sovereign immunity as a contractor. In terms of, to be concrete about the healthcare context, which obviously does not involve, the vast majority of the purchasing doesn't happen through the federal government for drugs in this country, right? Question is, how does this apply? It's easy if there are federal procurement officers involved. That, then it's just like the Department of Defense and the VA did it back in the day. You procure the drugs, and your intermediaries are also covered by this. Contractors covered are covered by your immunity. And then, you know, the only remedy that the patent holder would have is a suit for compensation. So that's quite straightforward. And clearly, there would be an argument and probably clauses in the contracts that would say, yes, we agree, you know, we're buying these generic drugs. We are invoking 1498. And that's what happens in other procurement contexts, too. You write something into the contract, effectively. And that's enough to get both of those prongs satisfied. Okay, so if you're talking about instead programs like Medicare and Medicaid, federal programs, obviously these programs involve typically intermediaries of various sorts. The federal government can be not necessarily that involved in procurement in this context. That said, the case law is broad in the sense that there are cases, one of them being the airline or the fraudulent checks case, where there are private actors involved who are doing the infringing without any express agreement with the government, where the court looks at the structure of federal law and says, well, you have kind of an obligation to check for fraudulent checks. So we're actually going to imply consent in this case, and we see a benefit for the federal government. And so there are cases of that sort. The consent can even be implied by federal legal obligations. We also describe in some detail, which I won't go into here, various ways in which we think, specifically with Medicaid and Medicare, say a motivated secretary of HHS could say, yep, here's this way, in a contract in some context in Medicaid where they have contracts with companies, or simply in public statements, we agree that this use could be binding for the federal government and take on that liability. And successfully, because federal programs are so heavily funded by the federal government, Medicaid and Medicare, the ultimate payer, obviously the benefit to the federal government is clear. And so the question really would be, how do you show consent? And what's interesting is there's not really much case law about these kinds of scenarios because the context tends to be more direct government procurement. So, but I don't think looking at that case law, it would be hard to, with the involvement of the HHS in particular, to say, or CMS in some context, to say that this is cloaked under the sovereign immunity of the federal government for those federal programs. So what about private and state-run programs? That's a kind of more wide-open question. And I think you'd really have to look closely at some of the cases like the checks case and see whether or not you could figure out a way that the government could, in fact, cloak its sovereign immunity, cloak the sort of private sector or state-run programs with its sovereign immunity. That's, I think, more speculative. At some point, presumably, although what's interesting is it's not written into the law, there's some limit to and some sort of delegation notion to the ability of a federal agent anywhere, because there's no specificity about who has to give this permission, saying, yep, we agree, the federal government's liable. So that sort of reaches what we think of as the far limits. I'd be interested in, you know, kind of trying to explore more what those limits, you know, how firm those limits are. But clearly the best uses are very obviously federal government purchaser and federal programs. We also have a section in our paper about state prisons, which because there's a federal constitutional obligation to provide drugs in prison, we think can also be incorporated into this, which in public health terms is a big, big deal. What about the FDA? So what we're talking about here is the government buying generics or threatening to buy them and then getting a good deal, right? So what if the generics aren't registered, as typically they wouldn't be, right? So we think there are two ways to address this if the government's going to use its contractors or, you know, others involved in these federal programs are going to use this. I think that the best way to think about this is that the drugs should be registered. I think that, you know, mainstream players are probably not going to want to do this without registration. And there are different ways to register. If there's no data exclusivity, And then you can simply come in through an ANDA application, right, which I guess probably most of you are familiar with, right? That's the normal application for a generic drug. What about the patents and the possibility that you get sued under the Hatch-Waxman Act because there's patents, right, which would normally prohibit you? That actually I don't think is any problem because you simply certify that you're doing this by and, you know, on behalf of the federal government, which means it's non-infringing, and there's good case law about this. And you simply say, yes, that would stop me if I was infringing, but I'm not infringing, and here's my argument for why I'm not infringing. So I think if there's no data exclusivity, you register the drug, it takes a little while, could have some interesting interaction with some of the proposals about the FDA bumping it to the head of the queue, cases where there's no competitor, right? So could be done relatively quickly. If you have data exclusivity, as will be the case for a really new drug, but not necessarily for some of these things like the EpiPen, right? If you have data exclusivity, then you have this issue about what to do. You can't use ANDA because of the data exclusivity. I think you could probably just file an NDA. And treat it as a new drug, and then the FDA would have discretion to determine how much evidence was necessary to actually approve this as a new drug. And in that context, because the FDA has so much discretion, again, if the FDA were motivated, potentially could be creative about how much evidence was in fact required. Particularly here, you also have the concern of not wanting to run duplicative clinical trials that are unnecessary, but perhaps just some very modest minimal clinical showing that could permit registration of that sort. There's also the possibility of simple enforcement discretion. I was talking about this earlier, that the FDA does have some enforcement discretion. I think that's less likely as an avenue for something that's really institutionalized. And there's reasons to be happy to discuss if you guys want to talk about that. Okay. I've been talking for almost long enough, so let me just say something about Bayh-Dole. So we will have a long session on Bayh-Dole, but one of the issues with Bayh-Dole is that it clearly reaches drugs that have patents that were all funded in part by the government. But there's this question about what do you do about government-funded drugs where it's been transferred to the industry and then there's additional patents, these kind of hanger-on, typically quite weak, minimal patents on dosage forms, on formulations, on, you know, crystalline forms, whatever it is. Those are contexts in which you have the potential to use Bayh-Dole and 1498 together to get a generic registered, and then to simply buy the generic and say, well, insofar as that was a valuable innovation, come to the Court of Federal Claims and make your argument about what your compensation ought to be. And I know that, I said a fair amount earlier about the kind of risk of uncertainty around compensation. This would be a nice case for you if you were a, you know, sort of government procurement officer, because you don't only have the upside, you know, we're not going to pay more than we would have paid, but also there's no punitive damages, by the way, in this context. That's also very clear. But you also have, you know, trivial patents, many of which could be invalidated in litigation, right? The government can always counterclaim in litigation and say, well, that's not a valid patent. And so you really do have, I think, a lot of interesting synergy between 1498 and Bayh-Dole. And I think similarly, thinking about drugs that are simply off patent, like the EpiPen sort of scenario, where there's a big political, I mean, so imagine, when is this practically most usable? I think one plausible scenario is you have a real big concern about the cost, price increases, or the cost of a drug with either lots of public domain components or Bayh-Dole rights attaching to it, and a trivial innovation that is in fact the barrier to reasonable pricing. With the EpiPen, we know that there really isn't any research costs, right, justifying those price increases and so forth. So that's a scenario where I think there's some real interesting potential to try to invoke this. Again, easiest for a government procurement officer. By the way, I think that I'm not a procurement lawyer, but I think that provision on procurement law about patents is still good law, right? So that as a procurement officer, you're not supposed to be a patent agent. You're not supposed to be looking at patents. The issue, I think, is actually really more on the registration side. So I'll just say practically, you know, if a procurement officer wanted to procure a drug in this way, I think what would happen is you'd say, I'm going to solicit some bids. In those bids, anybody who accepts it, I'll write by consent. And then let's get that drug registered, go through either ANDA or this other route. And then either you negotiate compensation in the background or they sue you in federal court and you make your case. So I think I'll stop there because I've said an awful lot. I know there were some questions that you we talked maybe about addressing that I haven't addressed, but I know Rob has also got some stuff to say, and we should move on.
Because I got to start, you know, scratching in a second. I got to have the mic working. So I kept this away because I thought we would have PowerPoints, but conveniently I don't. So we're okay here. I'm going to be more of a respondent, both to Amy's remarks and also to Zach's really great presentation. With just a couple of things, and I think we have a bit of a conversation, and then we'll open it up. I think one of the really useful things about looking back at the history, and even going back, you know, 100 years back of the history, is to sort of go back to some first principles and remind ourselves of how much has changed in the recent past to sort of free our minds to think more creatively about better solutions. So one thing going all the way back, as Zach did and as Amy was doing, is just to remind ourselves that really 1498 is actually a grant of rights to private holders rather than a restriction. In the sense that the traditional law is that the government doesn't get sued, period. And the government's willingness to be sued is a conveyance to private property holders. That's a pretty useful starting point to think about. We're not actually taking things from the government, and we're not taking things from private holders. We're just restricting how much we've given them over time. The second thing that's related to that is to remember that the property we're talking about here is not handed down from high. It is granted by the government. And of course, you know, everybody, anyone who went to law school knows that all property rights are government and socially determined anyway. But that's most clear with patent rights, which are intangible. You have to go to the government and register it. You got to make a showing of an invention and all that kind of stuff. So when you're talking about the right of the private holder, you're talking about a right that is really explicitly and in more plain ways than other contexts provided by the government in the first place. And then when we're talking in the context of government procurement, the government is being hijacked by private property holders whose private property is based on a grant from the government in the first place. And it makes a lot of sense to be pretty robust in thinking about what the government use is, the government use of a private property right that the government conferred in the first place, again, in a way that's more explicit than is the case in other private property contexts. One of the things that Zach didn't get into as much, and maybe the later panel will, is the history of Bayh-Dole is, it's important both for the march-in right that we focus on that came out of it, but sort of the broader political debate that was going on was a complete transformation about our understandings about the disposition of government property and government-funded R&D. It wasn't just a small thing. It wasn't like that no one had ever thought about it. There was an affirmative idea that government inventions would be put in the public domain because the public funded them, and of course they would be available to everybody. And the switch with Bayh-Dole, and there were actually a series of laws that were passed, not just Bayh-Dole, was the culmination of about a decade-long fight based on really bad evidence, but a huge concern about competition from Japan, sort of the China of its day, and a flip in our thinking. And it didn't happen, you know, just on its own. It happened because there had been a really concerted campaign. As it turns out, industry had a big part in that, but the universities had an even worse part in it because they had their own narrow pecuniary interest. And sort of a weird part of the story where universities who aren't, you know, important economic players were big drivers in the whole story. But I think thinking about all those things reminds us that we really should be very ambitious in our sense of what the government rights ought to be. In the context then of 1498, I mean, we sort of go through that whole history, but the most frequent usage of 1498 is in the defense area. And again, it's sort of helpful to open up our minds. Sorry, Fred, I haven't seen you in a long time, but I can't see you and not think about law school per se. So one of the useful things for people who go to law school is you go through these, you go in, you don't really know what you're talking about. Because you're not constrained by any actual evidence, you have the ability to imagine scenarios. So you do this hypothetical. What about this? What about that? What about this? The Defense Department is kind of like that. It's like this whole alternative world to the way everything else works because there's so little budget constraint and because they have such a sense of absolute imperative about achieving their objectives. So you look at 1498 and you have this real world hypothetical. The Defense Department view is we're not letting private property holders get in the way of us doing what we need to do. If we need to build a weapon, we're going to build the weapon. We'll work out later what we're going to pay you, but you don't get to hold us up. And we're not going to pay too much either. And that's sort of how it works. And that's not such a bad way to think about it for other priorities that we might have besides building missiles or night goggles or whatever. And I think if when you take that, when you have that perspective, it's really important to go through all the detailed things that Amy just touched on, but she's written a lot about. But it tells you that all those things are totally resolvable with any political will whatsoever. So I don't actually agree in the case of the VA that and the look at Sovaldi that the main issue was uncertainty about what the compensation would be to Gilead. I think the main worry was the main issue was they were scared. And no one had done it before and they were scared of doing it. And if they wanted to do it, they would have done it. And they would have resolved the compensation issues pretty easily. In fact, they never would have reached the compensation issues because there would have been a negotiation, which they easily could have understood if they cared to understand it. But they didn't have the mindset approaching these issues that the Defense Department would. We're just going to do this. And I think even on the most complicated issues in 1498, which are the registration issues that Amy was touching on, again, if you want to be creative, it's easy to solve the problems. So President Bush wanted to create a global AIDS program. There was a whole question about how we were going to have, how the government, the U.S. government was going to pay for drugs that weren't FDA approved. And they created a parallel universe of FDA approval called tentative approval. It's approval without being approved. And they solved the problem. The problems are totally solvable if there's any political will. So I think the existing statute puts us in pretty good shape. I think Amy and others have delved into the case law background stuff of this, and most of the problems can be reasonably well resolved. But for sure, you know, there are things that could be done to improve things. I think and maybe I'm not sure if this is the conversation for now or later on, but thinking in terms of some of the improvements, one point to consider, again, sort of in light of this history, is thinking not just about tweaking 1498 itself or creating like a special right for the VA or Medicare or whoever to use things, but to actually embed the government use right in the grant of the patent itself. Because whenever there's going to be a usage of the patent, it's still going to be constrained by the Fifth Amendment. Because it is a kind of taking, effectively. There's always going to be this background idea that there's some just compensation, and you're stuck with whatever the jurisprudence is on just compensation. But if the grant of the property right in the first place was constrained by the notion that the government had a right to use it, that the monopoly power did not extend in the same ways to, say, government procurement or any other procurement you wanted, or any other usage you wanted to establish, then you can escape some of the difficulties that come when we have to sort of after the fact deal with compensation issues. So those are my quick remarks, and why don't we go to your queries, Anna.
Do you
want to
respond?
Just two things. One, I think that your point about political will is well taken, and I think is right. These are all resolvable problems. On the takings point, though, I mean, I don't think this implicates takings at all, and the reason is because there never was a property right to begin with, and that's actually what the courts have said about it is, you know, and this is part of takings law. If the government never gave you a property right to begin with, it can't take it away, and because this has always existed, this limitation on liability has always existed, not clear that it implicates takings at all, although there are some people who've said, well, if it does, at least there's compensation, right? So I think that that issue is one that we ought to be mindful of, and it's like not at all a reason not to do what you're describing. But this is part of why the history is also important, is that in takings context, if the government never gave you a property right, and this limitation's always been there, then it's not obvious that you have any rights to be taken away. And that's how the courts have actually thought about this.
How about now?
Perfect. Okay. So thank you both for that. I want to ask two follow-up questions and then maybe turn this a bit to the audience as well. But my first one is I want to take it back a moment and think about other models for addressing some of the concerns that Amy raised in terms of HCV. So other models have been put forward. For instance, a prize model. Most recently, Peter Bach and Mark Trusheim put forward an idea that the government could actually buy Gilead, sell off its parts, and just keep the HCV franchise and use that approach. Now, each of these things have different advantages and drawbacks. They're all different approaches. And what I'd like to hear from both Amy and Robert is, under what circumstances would you consider pursuing one model or the other over the other, and a little bit more about how you might approach those differences?
So, that was really loud. So there's lots of things a prize model could do for you that this can't. One of those things would be there's areas where we think there's not enough research and we'd actually like to put research focus, or we'd like to better deal with some of the intrinsic kind of conflicts of interest within pharma. A lot of my work these days has been about clinical trial transparency and sort of the kind of what are some modest reforms we might make to try to get a hold on the conflict of interest when you both sell the drug and produce the information about the drug. So I think there's things like that that a prize model potentially could be helpful for, but also certainly for kind of orienting in a more public health focused direction the way that research happens. But you could think about 1498 as like an ex post prize model where, like, okay, we set a prize after the fact and we want to ensure now we know how much R&D costs were and so forth. And so you can think about it in that way. And some of my colleagues who I've talked about this, hey, this is like a prize. It's just like later on. I was like, yeah, okay. So Peter Bach has suggested buying Gilead. Well, how much was it going to cost? $150 billion or something like that. Yeah, which is amazingly less than we think we could spend if we wanted to buy at current prices all the HCV drugs we'd need for the American population. Wow. So I think one thing is that if you look at the way that I think you should look at 1498 is this kind of, well, let's compensate you for your R&D. And in that context, that would be way overcompensating because we know that the R&D, even risk adjusted, came nowhere close to that. And so there's a lot of waste involved in that kind of a proposal. It doesn't mean there's not also, if that were your only option, not also a lot of potential savings involved. There could be. But that's a lot to pay for a drug that we think from publicly available evidence cost between Sovaldi and Harvoni probably $600 million, $700 million to create, right? There are reasons to actually think in incentive terms, it's a bad thing to pay companies like $150 billion, you know, they have more drugs than that, but like to pay companies vastly more than the R&D actually costs, and that it induces wasteful effort and R&D that is around me too drugs and so forth. So that's, I think, one way to think about the Bach thing.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the, I have to wait for it to warm up. One of the, maybe I should get yours because yours is really powerful. You know, one of the things the prize model speaks to is that the system, the current system is utterly irrational. And so it's an alternative system that intends to be rational. There are other possible ways to introduce sort of systematic and systemic rationality into drug development. Unless you used 1498 or something like it all the time, it's actually not that. It's not a replacement system. It's a constraint on abuse system. And you could, you know, a lot of us think it would be great if it was used all the time, but that's from going effectively to zero to all the time. That's a big move. On the buyout of Gilead thing, you know, I think that's partly provocative and partly, you know, partly serious. I like that Peter's become a socialist, as I told him. But it speaks to sort of the, it's a couple things. One of those is, you know, the utter irrationality again in this market and the sort of the weird things, because the idea is you'd take the hepatitis drugs, or at least a right to the hepatitis drugs out, you'd sell off the rest, actually pretty useful. So maybe the actual cost to the government, maybe it wouldn't be 150, maybe it'd be 50 billion or who knows. And that turns out to be as Amy said, like a lot less than what you'd spend if you were just buying the drugs to provide drugs to the people who need them. It may even be less, and this is a different point, but it relates to the other thing I want to say. It may be less than what the government actually will spend over time. It's a little hard to say that way. One of the things that that proposal speaks to is kind of the gap between what the government is likely to spend and how many people are likely to be treated versus what you want to do as a public health measure, which is treat everybody. And I think it was useful to highlight that. In this particular case, it may be that the numbers line up at such that it actually is a relatively sensible way to go. It's definitely not as sort of intellectually sort of fluid and sound and kind of just policy appropriate as a licensing system would be.
That's helpful. I think the actual, just to relate back to what the actual number was, it was at the top line, I think, $157 billion. It's much less after you sell it off for the parts, including the corporate jet. So to your point about inefficiencies.
plus, driving down the price.
Yeah.
Pharma now, it's getting cheaper.
But there's something else that I want to relate this back to. Sorry.
She's saying Trump could get us a good deal, right?
You mentioned earlier about the system being irrational, and that's actually a really salient point here, right? Because companies will price to what the market will bear. And what the market will bear isn't always an efficient price point. It's frequently related to the amount of rebates and the cost that go to intermediaries in the system, which really raises the price and has actually incentives that distort it in the upward direction, right? So I could see a hypothetical scenario in which a company is making an investment decision between two products, one a curative therapy and another one a therapy that offers some incremental improvement over the existing standard of care, but not curative and maybe a little bit less risky as being seen as highly desirable for takeover or like a compulsory licensing sort of arrangement. And so in that scenario, is it feasible to to what degree do you have to consider when you're pursuing compulsory licensing, like through 1498, the existing system under which drug pricing sort of occurs, and what would you have to address in order to reduce some of these disincentives? Does that make any sense?
It does make sense. So I think this, like 1498 again, I think that if it were started to be used more often, it would have an effect on the way all drugs were priced. Unless you anticipate it being used for every drug, then it's likely to be used for drugs that matter more in clinical terms, right? Because you're not going to bother with a drug that actually has no real benefit, of which unfortunately there are many. So in that context, there's, you know, this question that arises about, are you going to then sort of distort incentives to invest in truly valuable drugs? I guess there's a couple things to say about that. One, so the way that we've thought about what the government ought to offer as compensation is you ought to ensure that for every single project it's profitable going forward, right? And that's why you risk adjust and even add a profit if you like that approach. So you have to believe either that there's intense scarcity of capital or a large surplus of scientific opportunity to mean that you'd get a distortion, even though this was a profitable opportunity, somebody's going to forego it. And I'm not sure that that's the case. In fact, if you look at the literature about what the elasticity of innovation is in the industry, it's pretty low. So it suggests like maybe there is either a lot of capital and or not a lot of scientific opportunity, so that you're taking the opportunities that you have and you're not going to forego one because you simply have to choose between, you know, the long-term diabetes drug and the cure for cancer. You'll take the cure for cancer even if you're assuming in this scenario that the government's going to get really interested in that one and is less going to be interested in the other. And the other thing that I'd say about this is that the potential upsides of getting serious about addressing the kind of deadweight loss associated with monopoly pricing are so big, right? When you think about the difference between, let's say, $250 billion to cure everybody with hep C and like $5 billion. Like, take a little bit of that money and put it into R&D. If you're really worried about this problem, like, take some of that money and put it into public R&D, which we know has more significant returns to health. I mean, if we look at the, you know, kind of evidence about where the most significant drugs come from, I think that's a very reasonable thing to do, and I would support that. I think we ought to think about, you know, how do we move towards a system that prioritizes really innovative research. And so one of the things you could think about what to do with the savings available after this is, well, if you're worried about that, let's double down on truly innovative research and and help support it. I, frankly, though, I'm not that concerned about the distortion because I think you'd have to know things that we don't know and have reason to think maybe aren't true about the industry.
That's interesting. I don't know. I mean, you've looked into it in more detail than me. I mean, that's sort of the traditional critique of the industry, that that's already the case, that the incentive is to do non-curative, to do treatment, not cures. I don't actually know the empirical data on that. What is sure, though, is that there are tons of opportunities, sort of public health research opportunities that are not pursued because there's no profit involved. And cancer is sort of the obvious example. There's some money now that goes into tobacco control. It's not trivial, but I mean, there's no question on that. You don't have to sort of speculate about environmental causes, and there's a pretty big distortion there. So I think those distortions are pretty well written into the existing system beyond what would have come from use of 1498.
I think at this point, Jamie, shall we open it up to the floor?
Well, thanks both for really excellent presentations. Amy, it's glad to hear you've thought through some of these things in such great detail. I want to initially just react to what probably, let us call it, a red herring idea of buying Gilead and why that's a truly terrible idea. Because what you would be doing is rewarding bad behavior. The one piece of necessary reading for anybody in this field over the past number of years is the Senate staff report on the pricing of Sovaldi. And if you read the mechanics of that whole process and the financial engineering and how public health budgets were looked at and the way the price was arrived at, and if you come away thinking that that's the right way to price drugs in the United States, then really, probably there's no hope for any of us in reforming the system. And so I would view what to do with Gilead as more go after them from an antitrust standpoint for excessive pricing and have the Department of Justice and the FTC claw back the money that they have taken advantage of the public in this situation, as opposed to buying them out and rewarding them for this conduct. Now, that's a different question than Amy's question of, is there a reasonable price for buying out a royalty stream, you know, kind of at the beginning of the situation and paying someone the reasonable price? But bear in mind that they didn't do the research, that Pharmaset did the research, so it even goes back a stage before that. So, sorry, I couldn't help myself on paying out the Gilead shareholders. But, so we have this very interesting idea now coming, right, which I just to tie in a little bit to 1498, we do have a president who says that the way I'm going to bring prices down is I'm going to negotiate the heck out of the prices with the pharmaceutical industry. And, of course, Amy points out, I think appropriately, that may be possible with the VA where you have direct purchasing. It ties, though, back into the kind of original problem with the Medicare Part D extension when we have the statutory provision that the federal government won't negotiate prices. So that was probably the biggest marker that Congress laid down in terms of, you know, don't try to take advantage of the pharmaceutical industry, because that literally made no sense at all. The argument was from the pharmaceutical industry, well, if you let the government negotiate with us, the prices will be too low. Which is kind of an interesting argument. But so you could extend this idea of federal price negotiation, which is kind of what Amy's suggesting, more broadly from the direct purchasing to the intermediated purchasing with the Medicare and the Medicaid, for example. And then you would get into the question, if you're really going to negotiate with someone and said, I need a lower price, and they say, well, I'm not going to lower the price, and I'm just not going to sell it to you at that low price, that's when the negotiator from the government side needs to be able to step in and say, well, we do have a solution to that. And our solution to that is we're just going to use the drug, and we're going to determine what the royalty is, and then we're going to pay it to you, even if you have to go through the intermediate function of the court. So, It's not inconceivable that given the current rhetoric coming out of the present administration, that really one way to lower the prices is to A, have the government actually step in and do the direct and indirect negotiation, but then B, having the necessary backup of 28 U.S.C. 1498 as a mechanism for ultimately determining a fair price. And I have just solved the entire problem. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Fred.
This is probably a question for Robert. A recent case in the Federal Circuit just held that patent rights were not property rights, but were public rights. And accordingly, that was appealed to the Supreme Court on cert, and the court declined to take the case. But it may come back. Do you think that this public rights versus private property helps your argument? And I should note that the issue in that case, which is MCM versus HP, involved the right to a jury trial before a patent could be nullified. So it seems to me that this MCM case does have a bearing on your argument that what Congress gives can be taken away. What you're running into, of course, is that it didn't come from Congress. It came from the Constitution. And that's the difficulty you're facing with that argument. It's not what government gives. It's what the Constitution gives.
I'll just say, I don't know that case in particular, although I'll read it. It's interesting. On the taking side, I guess I think what's interesting is there are not a lot of takings cases, if that's sort of where we're headed, is sort of thinking about takings and how does it apply. I think there's reason to think that if you just take, this is why I asked the question about the Atomic Energy Act, like if you just take the patent, there's no compensation, and that's exactly what happens. And there's no argument that you could see this coming as a patent holder, that of course would see that as a takings. What's interesting is there's not even law about that. but that is not to say that in circumstances like this, and this gets to the kind of regulatory takings context, right, where the government's never going to use it in the first place, that takings law actually applies. So I guess that's just a brief response to that. Then if there's compensation, there would obviously be the takings, but it's been compensated.
I'd like to just comment on this issue of what happens if the intervention in the patent drives incentives down to a certain level. And I think that it's a mistake to put on the patent system the entire weight of the incentive system or the financing system for the development of new drugs. Most of the cost to develop new drugs has nothing to do with the patent. It has to do with the cost of conducting clinical trials and things like that. Often the patents are developed out of a relatively small investments in some cases, where the driver was a public sector research that either a private or a public party at some point was able to sort of patent. You see this with CRISPR and things like that, where it was a sort of a community that was in working on something, but somebody ends up sort of getting the brass ring at the end. But the cost of the clinical trials is a big expense. So should the patent system be the thing that you use to finance clinical trials? That's really the question you have. And right now, that's one of the principal ways you do it. But if you were to reduce what you get from the patent monopoly, in orphan drug development, the federal government subsidizes 50% of the cost of qualifying trials. That lowers the cost by half of doing those trials. That's a pretty, you could deepen that subsidy, extend it to other drugs if you wanted to. The prize system, the priority review voucher, which is a form of a prize system that's been running between $125 and $350 million, has really stimulated a lot of interest in registering drugs that people didn't care about before. They're trying to figure out what people are, what's going to qualify now. I think that you can create financial incentives in the back end that are not related to the price of the drug. The priority review voucher is an example that we're doing right now, and the prize system is one that people, including us, think that you should do. And you can subsidize the trials like the orphan drug things to lower the cost of doing trials. You don't have to put everything on the patent to finance clinical trials. It actually creates a lot of problems in doing so. So I think that the types of, you know, going forward on things like government use or the other things will be described, you shouldn't dismiss them out of hand because you're so committed to the idea that they would reduce innovation unless you think that nothing else will be done to address your concerns over innovation.
I noticed nobody's here from Gilead, so we're sort of trying them in absentia. I feel compelled to, you know, hear something as to what they would argue in response. And I imagine it would be something like, look, we put $600 million down, put it on lottery, you know, roulette wheel number 22, we got the hit, and now you're going to say we don't get our money for taking that risk. And not only that, did we win, we don't have a treatment, we have a cure for a very debilitating disease. I'd imagine that would their argument is. My question to the panel is, how would you articulate their argument, and then what would your response be?
Given the overall kind of approach to gambling in this country, I mean, I don't think they would say we won the roulette wheel, and so you ought to pay us all the money in the federal treasury. I think they would say, I don't think that would be a good argument. I think they would say that they, at least what they do say, they say, well, you know, other ways, if you have liver cancer, that's very expensive. And they say largely that, right? What's interesting is that it used to be all the public health advocates saying we have to pay for value in drugs because our paradigm problem was crappy drugs. And so what we didn't want to do is pay hundreds of thousands of dollars for drugs that did very little or didn't help at all. So now what's interesting is that has largely become something that you hear from, like, you should pay for value. And I think the trouble with that, and we do a little thought experiment in our paper, and we say, well, that's interesting. Like, you know, on one hand, yes, I mean, you don't want to pay for no value. But if you don't pay any attention to R&D costs, like you just like don't allow yourself to look over there, you can end up doing some crazy things. It's like Martin Shkreli is like, my drug is very valuable because it saves lives. Well, like, did you do any R&D? No, I didn't. Well, but still, it's very valuable. And so you could be dead otherwise. So aren't you willing to pay $10,000? Like, you know, well, yes, if my choice is being dead, but you didn't do any R&D. Like, that's crazy from an economics perspective. I mean, that's I think, one of the scenarios, right, that we have to have in mind when we think about, like, the fact that there's value as a disconnected entirely from R&D can't be the right way to think about what the appropriate amount is to pay for a drug. So that is tends to be Gilead's response. There's value in this, which I agree with. But when the value is as utterly, you know, there really is this problem that when you have a valuable, you know, intervention, if you price it exorbitantly, you have, it's just rent seeking, right? You're just getting massive amounts of money out of the federal treasury, in part because we've started to think about drugs as a right. I mean, it's not exactly a right, but like we start to mandate coverage of drugs, right? And so, yeah, it's not a right, but it started, you know, there's mandated, and Rachel's been writing about this too. There's mandated coverage of drugs, you know, in federal programs of certain sorts. And that means you can kind of hold the government over a barrel. I'm sorry, you can't negotiate with me. I can charge you whatever I like. Doesn't matter what I spend on R&D. It's a little like, you know, I don't know, your house is burning down, the fire department shows up and says, like, okay, how much are you going to pay me? Right? Like, that's not a public-minded system, and no economist would set a system up that way. And that's kind of what my response to Gilead's response would be.
Yeah, so the industry still uses the R&D thing, it's cures at a high level. It's R&D, innovation, they still use it. R&D is gone, that's too technical. Innovation sometimes, but it's not as good as cures. Cures is what they're locked in on, and it's a pretty good term. But what Gilead has not talked about is their investment in the R&D. They didn't put $600 million on the table, they bought the drug after it had already been pretty far. So they put down $11 billion on the table, which is already sort of priced in, but all the risk. So you actually could identify it if you wanted to sort of go through the acquisition of sort of the Peter Bach model. You can take the $11 billion and say, based off of that, and it's not that much more you'd want to go. But what they are talking about is the value from is the value. And I think, following what Amy's saying, I just think that's it's really important that we not get locked in on in terms of the value framework, because it leads to these crazy outcomes. And of course, you can compare against, you know, an out of control medical establishment. So it's true. I mean, hospitalization is really expensive. Or the value of a life, right? We have our government puts a price on the value of a life. It's between $5 and $10 million. It doesn't mean that you don't take into account the actual cost of what a remedy is to save the life. You automatically give everybody $5 to $10 million, you know, $5 to $10 million. And the whole value thing doesn't make sense when you ignore the fact that all the pricing is in the context of monopoly grants, that are government granted monopolies in the first place. Like it's not a market like any other market. If it were, then we'd get a different kind of pricing system, and you could say, well, yeah, people don't want to pay above the value, but they've got a competitive market to go for.
All right, so we have reached the, we have one more, and then I think we'll...
one more forceful comment.
Everybody has to have some lunch, so.
A comment and a question for Amy. Just a comment about the Gilead investment. They paid $11 billion for Pharmaxis, but the goodwill, the value of Sovaldi was only $74.2 million, and they're amortizing the $11 billion as an intangible asset, so it's not a sunk cost. So it's grossly overestimating their investment. But I wanted to just respond to Amy's discussion of the handling of the exclusivity issue. You suggested that one way to get around the data exclusivity issue would be to get the generic registers through an NDA, and that the FDA could be creative in the requirement for evidence. I'm a bit troubled by that because the FDA is required to consider, is required to be presented with substantial evidence, which means data from adequate and well-controlled trials. If there are no trials, and the only trials are those that have been submitted in support of the originator, they've got nowhere to go. I don't think that that's an adequate workaround, except that we are entering a new era if the EMA are publishing clinical trial data in full, then that might be a way of utilising clinical trial data in support of an NDA that would allow FDA to work around the data exclusivity. I just wondered if you wanted to comment on that.
One of the interesting things about the FDA that in this context doesn't necessarily look so good is that a lot of the FDA is not statutorily determined, but is determined by FDA practice, even draft guidances, not even regulations. So, you know, whether the FDA has the discretion to say, well, what is an adequate and well-controlled trial? I mean, we actually know that from some research a colleague of mine at Yale did, Jill Ross, that the FDA has approved many drugs with only one trial, with trials that were not randomized, right? So, and could they create an alternative pathway that said this is what an adequate and well-controlled trial in this context is? I think there's this historical practice where they've done that. Again, it requires motivation from the agency. So I think DEA has discretion, an enormous amount of discretion in terms of how it defines that. And I would say we should be concerned about, you know, a requirement that would be a very high burden on a company, in part for the ethical reasons that you don't need more safety and efficacy data, and so why would you want to put people through that in a trial? And so maybe you should be able, for example, to look at publicly available evidence, not actually data from a trial, but data from public regulatory submissions, data. They're actually, in the Sovaldi context, there have been clinical trials of the generics. So, you know, in some scenarios, you might have that. And remember, we're also only talking here about drugs where you really wanted to go after them in the first five-year window, where the NDA option really is the main one. So I think the FDA has a lot of discretion. I think that the European process is likely to be hidden behind a contract that would not allow you to do that. That's my guess. We don't quite know yet, I think. But, you know, it's another area that if you want to get serious about it, I think there's both things the agency could do to do this well. And you could, you know, legislate if you wanted to.
Yeah, I think you're right to say you want to sort of blow up the FDA approval process because it's really important. And the examples that Amy's are pointing to are examples of abuse at the FDA where they're not doing their job. You don't want to sort of fast track more abuses. But you, at the same time, you can say these are special circumstances. You can. It's not that hard. First of all, it's all arbitrary. Again, you're just trying to work around some stupid government grant. It doesn't make sense in the first place of exclusivity. So it's not that hard to be creative about it and say, this is what it's about. And when they want to do these things, when DOD wants to do it, but even when FDA wants to do it, they find solutions. It's only, when there's not that will and we're kind of in this place and it's trying to be super creative to come up with this maze solution, you kind of get to stuff that's not so satisfactory. But I think, again, when people want to actually affirmatively want to do it, not that hard to come up with the ways to do it that makes sense.
NDA or a BLA, because if it was an ANDA or a biosimilar application, then you'd be could get caught by the market exclusivity, which you couldn't.
Yeah, but look what they did with a tentative approval. They just made it up. It's completely made up. Tentatively approved. They could tentatively approve over an exclusivity. They just could.
All right. Thank you all. It's a wonderful discussion.